Good morning, everybody. Morning. It's glad to see you guys today. I know there's, if you're in the building, it looks a little bit empty today, but I know there's quite a few folks who are sick, and some people are starting their Christmas travels and all that. So if you're watching us online, we are incredibly grateful for that. Thank you. If you're here in the building, I'm excited to see you guys today as well. It's good. It's good to be in God's house together. So a few things, if our ushers could come and get ready to take up offering, especially as on a day like today where we look around and notice that not a lot of folks are in the building, that those instances become more important than ever to at least consider online giving. You can schedule those things so that way your tithe gets to us even on those days where we can't have church because of the weather, or if you're out of town traveling, or if you get sick. That way, you don't have to spend the extra money on a stamp to mail it to us. You can schedule that, and it is always taken care of. If you would like to do that, at least think about it and consider it. The app also does lots of other great things. You can see a calendar on there. You can see a directory. And if you need help getting set up with a directory, it is a two-step process. So if you're not in the directory and you think you should be, come and find me, and we'll get you figured out. Speaking of directories, one of the biggest reasons people use those is to send Christmas cards. And we have our Christmas card box is set up over by the restrooms. I found it the other day, and we set it up. We're better late than never, but if you planned on doing Christmas cards for our church folks, you can find their names on a box over towards the bathroom. So make sure you check that box before you go home. You may have some cards in there that you get to take home and read. A few things coming up that we need to be aware of. This afternoon is our opportunity to serve at Amy's House of Hope. And we don't have to cook today. We got a message yesterday saying that some other groups had donated a lot of extra food, so we just had to show up with desserts. And we need, but we do need a lot of hands to help with the service and with the serving there this afternoon from 3 to 5:30. So get there about 2:45 or so, and we'll get stuff ready, and people will start coming in the door around 3. We'd love to see you there to kind of, are they serving next week? Do you know? This may be the last Sunday before Christmas, and so we want to try to make it as special for these folks as we can. So that is this afternoon. Next Saturday is our gift wrapping at the mall from 10 to 5, and we're really excited about that. That's always a lot of fun. We have an official sign-up sheet. Thank you to Thelma for that. There's so you can sign up for your time slots. I didn't use one last year, and like a bunch of people showed up at the same time, and then there was another period of time where it was just me, and it was bad for everybody. So make sure you sign up, and we can space ourselves out a little bit, because I don't want everybody to have to be there all day. If you want to be there all day and hang out with me, I would love that. But if you just want to come for a certain time, that helps you kind of space yourselves out a little bit. So we always have that staffed and ready. Some other stuff going on that you can see in your bulletin. Our Landmark Youth Group and Landmark Kids are having their little Christmas parties this Wednesday evening during their services. And so I know the kids are excited about that. I can't speak to what Landmark Kids are doing, but Landmark Youth, we are doing a fun little gift exchange. It is a gag gift, and it is $10 or less. Emphasis on the or less part. So whatever random junk you can find, it's going to be a lot of fun. So that is for the youth group and Landmark Kids. And I know there's a bunch of other things. Coming up in January, we're having a little baby shower for Amberly. And so you'll see that on your bulletin there as well. So that's a little bit ahead of schedule, but just want you guys to know. Make sure if you didn't grab one, a bulletin, grab one on your way out the door and check out the calendar on the app for updates as we change things. So I think that's it for our announcements. If you would stand as we pray together, and we will move to musical worship. It's in Jesus' name we come to you, and we just thank you for who you are and for what you've done. We ask that you would be over this service today, that you would speak to us through the songs, that you'd speak to us through the lighting of the candle here in just a minute as we reflect on the readings. We just ask that you'd move through this service today. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning, everyone.
In all this, I have given you an example that by such work we must support the weak, remembering the words of the Lord Jesus. For he himself said, "It is more blessed to give than to receive."
Joy is not merely a fleeting emotion. It is a state of the heart that comes from knowing that we are loved and cherished by our Father. Even amidst life's challenges and uncertainties, the joy of Jesus sustains us and satisfies our hearts, filling our hearts to overflowing. This overflow of the heart will greatly benefit others around us.
The Lord asks us to give freely to others as we ourselves have been given from Him.
What good is a gift of love or service if it is hoarded and kept instead of freely given? It becomes no gift at all.
We ask the Lord to empower us to give away to others the gift of the gospel of Jesus Christ.
The birth of Jesus is a message of great joy for all humanity. It is our reminder that God's abiding love is unconditional, and that through Jesus, we have the promise of deep, satisfying, perfect love. Just as the angel shared the good news with the shepherds, we are called to share this message of his love with the world around us.
It is truly more joyful to give than receive. May our joy in Jesus be evident in our thoughts, words, and actions. May each interaction we have be saturated in loving presence of Jesus.
As we light the candle of joy today, may our hearts burst with the truth that his love is really ours to have, to hold, and to give away to others. Remember, love gives.
Thank you for that lead into worship. That's what we're going to be singing about today. And what can we bring to God? Our worship, that's the very best thing.
Find the child delivered and calling.
decided to come and live down among us. And God, that you didn't stop living among us, that you're still with us today. Imagine a God that loves us, not someone that's far away, but you are with us in our everyday, day-to-day, mundane, the struggles, the joys, all of it. God, you're with us, and we thank you for that. I pray for the service today that you would help each one that has a part. Lord, I pray for the ones that are out sick today. There's so many, Lord. I pray that you would bless them and their families. And Lord, I pray for our kids as they go off to Children's Church in just a minute, Lord. Bless them, bless the workers, and God, in everything, help us to keep our focus on you this Christmas season. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to take a moment and dismiss our kids first, Children's Church. So, kids, have fun. We'll see you later. Get your kids if you send them. And we're going to take a time for fellowship. Say hello to everyone.
I was just talking to somebody earlier, and our service will be a little bit shorter today because so many people are out. The people who were supposed to do our special music are sick, so we want to think of the Fowler families. They're all out today. Cameron is out today, so we got a lot of stuff going on. So I was like, should I preach extra long to fill the time? And I decided no, so I'm not going to do that to you. But this is the third week of Advent, and thank you to the Croix for reading and lighting our candle for us today. And I'm excited that we could to continue thinking about Jesus' first arrival to us. And that's simply what that word Advent means. It means arrival. I know I've said that the last couple of weeks, but that's what it means. It means arrival. And so, and we use that most often when talking about Christmas, when Jesus comes to earth as a baby over 2,020 years ago. And I always like to give credit where it's due. Our sermon ideas and topic names have been provided by the CWC, a women's ministry arm of the Church of God. And I like to use them for continuity and unity with other Church of God congregations in North America. And all the this year they asked Pastor Jeremy Dixon from Center of Hope LA, in Inglewood, California, to provide the titles and topics, and then the rest of the stuff was up to me. So this morning, it is the God who gives a sign. So let's pray together and talk about that. God, we just thank you for who you are and for what you've done. We thank you for Christmas, that first Christmas so long ago, where you came to give to us not just Jesus and not just a Savior, although those are the most important things, but to also give us so many other things, so many byproducts, hope, joy, peace, comfort, so many other things. God, we just ask that this Advent season, as we reflect on the Christmas story that we would remember and recognize that it's not just a story like a bedtime story, but that this was real. And it was the moment you entered earth and changed everything. We ask that in the midst of all the busyness and sicknesses and all the other things this world throws at us this time of the year, that you would stand out first and foremost. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Now, the last 2 weeks, we have seen how God challenges our ideas as people of value and importance. When he decided to bring the Messiah to this world through Mary, first of all, who was considered by her society to be property, less than human, just in the midst of a transaction. And then last week we saw how God saw fit to announce the arrival of the Savior of the world to the lowest of the low in the night shift shepherds, not announcing his arrival to kings and royalty or with big fanfare, but to shepherds in the middle of the night. God cares for everyone, and like we see with the shepherds and with Mary, we have to embrace that truth too, that as Christ followers, we have to recognize that God loves to use the improbable and sometimes the undesirable people to accomplish his plans. It's not the people who have, not always the people who have their lives all together, whatever that means. I don't know if that's even possible, but God often uses the people who have given up trying to hold it together. And that's oftentimes what he uses. And sometimes we think that we have to do it the other way around. But as we've seen the last 2 weeks, that's not the case. Now, this morning, we kind of turn our attention to what some might be to consider the other end of the spectrum as we look at the Magi. Some people call them kings, right? We sing the song, "We Three Kings." We don't know if they were kings, probably not. And we don't know how many of them there were. We just assume three because three different gifts show up. But we would, a lot of times, would consider them to be the opposite end of the spectrum. They are obviously wealthy, and they came from another land far away and brought incredibly wonderful gifts. And so they're not necessarily the lowest of the low in society. But an important thing to recognize, they are not Jewish people. Jesus wasn't even for them, or at least we know later that he was, but they were not Jewish people. They didn't worship in synagogues. They didn't even live in Israel. They came from somewhere else. And so it would have been easy for them to be overlooked in the story as people that had nothing to do with what was happening. And so we're going to take a look at the Magi. Some of us would call them wise men. That's a way that it often is translated. And we find their piece of the story in Matthew chapter 2, starting in verse 1. It says, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea during the time of King Herod, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, where is the one who has been born King of the Jews? We saw his star when it rose and have come to worship him. So these guys studied stars, and in many of the religions of the time, you could interpret symbols and all kinds of things by seeing what the stars did. They didn't have telescopes and satellites and all the things that we have. They just saw constellations, and when things, they didn't understand rotational forces of Earth and how sometimes you get constellations in this time of the year and then sometimes you don't. They didn't have any of that stuff figured out. They just studied and looked for signs, and that was a lot of things that they did. And these guys, they say they saw his star. How do they know about his star? Where do they know that comes from? Well, we know from some other studies that these guys had access to the Old Testament, and they recognized the prophecies. And again, we don't know. We know that they weren't Jewish people. They weren't worshiping in the synagogues and things, but they probably had some kind of a melting pot of all kinds of religious stuff. They were just, you guys kind of know people like that, maybe, who take a little bit of this from this religion. Like, karma is a big one. A lot of Christians talk about karma. That's not a real thing, okay? That's not how it works. But if you have applied that to your life, sorry, but you're wrong. So, but we probably know people that do that. They're like, oh, I'll pray, and then there's karma, and then there's the beads, and then I'll do the stuff, and then they do the Catholic thing, and they just kind of have mixed it all together. We probably know people like that. The Magi were probably like that. They were based in some kind of an Eastern Oriental religion, or religions is probably where they were based, and then they had access to scriptures of other religions stuff, and they kind of have mixed them all together. But they recognize a new star. Something different has happened. And so they say, we saw his star. And now it's important. They go to Herod, who we've learned in this verse is king. At the time, he is the king of the Jews. Obviously, the Roman government is really in charge, but they kind of let King Herod rule over his little piece of property there in Israel. And so the Magi show up, and they're like, hey, where's the newborn king? And this causes problems, right? When King Herod heard this, he was disturbed. Now, if you have studied anywhere in the New Testament, you know the King Herod is disturbed, probably before this instance. The dude killed a bunch of people in his family. It's a whole soap opera of things. So now he's disturbed, and all Jerusalem with him. When he had called together all the people's chief priests and teachers of the law, he asked them where the Messiah was to be born. See, King Herod doesn't even know the scriptures. He has to call the other people to fill him in on all those Old Testament prophecies about the Savior. And in Bethlehem in Judea, they replied, for this is what the prophet has written, but you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For out of you will come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel. Then Herod called the Magi secretly and found out from them the exact time the star had appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem and said, go and search carefully for the child. As soon as you find him, report to me so that I too may go and worship him. Now we find out later that that's not his plan. His plan is to go and murder this dude, right? But I'm getting ahead of myself. That's just a fun fact. But after they'd heard the king, they went on their way, and the star they had seen when it rose went ahead of them until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were overjoyed. On coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshipped him. Then they opened their treasures and presented him with gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to go back to Herod, they returned to their country by another route. So God appears to them in a dream, is like, hey, don't go to that guy, he's crazy. And so they left and went the other way. And I'm not going to read the rest of this passage, but we find out later that King Herod finds out that they didn't come back. He got really mad, and he killed all of the children ages 2 and under in that neck of the woods. But God gave Joseph a vision, and they ran, and Jesus was actually raised in Egypt for a couple of years. A lot of times our little nativity scenes come with like three little wise men, and we put them there, and there's the baby Jesus and all that. They weren't there that first day. There's a few things that point to it. First of all, they came from a really long way away, and if the star showed up when Jesus was born, they probably got there a couple years after the fact. The fact that Herod takes out everybody 2 years and under points us to that. So the Magi didn't show up to your nativity scene with the shepherds, and it also tells us they went to a house where they were. So they probably showed up a year, 2 years later. So if you have your wise men in your nativity, you can like put them away. They're not there. But it's a fun story, right, with the gold and frankincense and myrrh, and we see them. Many of us know this story, many of us have heard of this. Again, they're part of our nativity scenes, and we think, oh, it's so nice, they came and they gave presents to baby Jesus. Isn't that wonderful? And it is wonderful. Now, usually when I talk about this part of the story, though, I like to focus on Herod, because there's murder and mystery and intrigue, and I think that's interesting, and how he goes a little bit crazy. But Pastor Jeremy, when he gave this topic, he kind of highlighted something else. He points out the fact that the Magi, really why they're included in this story, is not about the gifts that they bring, because anybody could have got those. What's important is how this shows God's inclusive nature and his steadfast love and pursuit of all people, whether they're believers or not. So Jesus didn't just come for those who would love him and accept them. Jesus came for everybody. And God loves all of mankind, even those who choose to go their own way. Although these Magi were not members of the Jewish faith, they identified this star, and they saw it in the east where they were, and they recognized it was special. They recognized the Old Testament prophecies, and then they followed it, right? They saw this star as a sign of a great king's birth, and God, in his infinite mercy, granted them the opportunity to witness and react to this divine message. He didn't pick Jewish people. He picked foreign people to go and recognize the Messiah. That's a big deal. He leads them on the path of faith, leading them right to Jesus. And this remarkable event demonstrates God's love and acceptance of all nations, all cultures, and all individuals. Like, God desires for all people to come to himself. It demonstrates his desire to bring everyone into the transforming presence of Jesus. See, God doesn't accept all religions or all things. Like, there are people who teach that just whatever you worship is fine. That's not what we're saying. God wants everybody to be changed through Jesus, and we know that there's lots of people who won't. But the fact is, God included the Magi, people who came from a different culture. We don't know if they went back saved, singing the praises of Jesus. We don't know. We never hear about them ever again once they leave. They probably went back to their mishmash of other religions and doing whatever they had been doing. But the fact is, God called somebody from outside to be in the presence of Jesus. And that's what he does even to this day. See, the inclusion of the Magi in this event challenges some of our, or at least my, preconceived notions about who Jesus wants, who God is calling, right? A lot of times we think, like, because we're Americans and we think America's the best, and in many ways it is, we think of Christians as us versus them. But it's not really, there's no verses there. God loves everybody and desires all people to come in. And so that's a preconceived notion. But this inclusion of the Magi serves as a reminder that God's grace and mercy aren't limited to the people we think it should be limited to. It's not limited to the people that we like. It's not limited to the people who grew up going to the churches we grew up going to. It's not limited to the people who talk like we talk or act like we act or think like we think. It's for everybody. It's an invitation to all men, women, and children, the entire world over, to be reconciled with God through Jesus. It's for everybody. And as we think about this truth, we need to be reminded that God's not limited by our understanding or our categories. So I'm sure that the people who had studied, when King Herod called together the priests and the teachers of the law, they probably would not have predicted that God would call Magi from a foreign country in to inform them that their king had been born. They probably never thought their mind. That was a category of people that we see all over the Old Testament, especially in the book of Jonah. They don't like any outsiders, and yet these are the ones coming to tell them that their Savior has been born. Like, how embarrassing is that? Like, you missed it. Somebody from a whole nother religion had to tell you about your thing. And so this, God's not limited by the way we understand things or by the way we would do things. So maybe we can be a little bit more like the Magi and seek him with open hearts and open minds. And maybe we can be a little bit more like God and open our hearts and minds to those around us who maybe don't know who he is. May we come ready to encounter his glory, no matter where we come from, and respond in faith. That's exactly what they did. And it's a powerful story that sometimes we gloss over, at least I do. I just like, oh yeah, they showed up, gold, frankincense, and myrrh, and it's just a fun word to say, right? But Jesus is for everybody. And that's what they show us. And it's easy to miss that. And I would have if it wasn't for Pastor Jeremy pointing this out. Now, I mentioned we don't know what happened with the Magi after they went home. We don't know. We'd never hear from them. We don't even know their names. They never pop up through Scripture ever again. Did they convert to Judaism? I don't know. Did they become the first Christian people? I don't know. Probably neither. But they had an encounter with the one true God because he led them to Jesus, because he did that. God still leads people to Jesus regardless of their background. And I know the news is full of bad news. You turn on the TV and there's not a lot of good news. And if you're a Christian person, depending on where you get your information, you may be kind of stuck in your corner thinking, oh, it's a bad time to be a Christian. Everybody hates us. The persecution is real. But the truth is, God is drawing people to himself all over the world, even as we speak. Matter of fact, the Church of God, the movement we belong to, it's kind of small in the United States. Maybe before you came here, you didn't know of any other Church of God churches outside of the five or so we have in this neck of the woods. The truth is, outside of the United States, this is one of the largest movements in the world. God is moving all over the world. God is moving in Muslim countries, converting people from Islam to Christianity. God is moving in China, where it's illegal to be a Christian, yet their numbers are growing every day. God is drawing people to himself from different places and different backgrounds all the time. So we're going to close here with just this thought. So, like, if God is calling out to everyone, even us here and now, even if you're in this room, even if you're watching at home, and God is still calling out to you. Maybe you haven't made that decision yet. But if you have, if you've already answered the call and experienced Jesus like the Magi did, the question is, what role are you going to play now? What are you going to do with that? Are you going to bring Jesus to other people? Regardless of their background, regardless of what they look like, are you going to share your faith with them? Will you serve at Amy's house and take these people who many of us would consider the least of these or would ignore or walk by in our society, right? Are we going to come and bring the gospel to them? We have a chance to do that this afternoon. Maybe you'll tell your coworkers or neighbors how Jesus has changed your life. Maybe you're going out to the mailbox or going out to your porch to get those millions of Amazon packages, right? And you happen to look up and see them outside. Maybe instead of just waving, you walk over and talk to them a little bit and tell them about what Jesus has done. Maybe you'll invite people to church. You don't have to do that just at Christmas time. You know, we have services every Sunday and Wednesdays too, you know. But maybe more important than that, will you maybe take some time and invite some people into your home and just explain to them what this season is all about for you? We have opportunities to do what God did for the Magi. That example is in there for us to follow. Jesus is for everybody. So we need to be for everybody when we tell them about who he is and what he's done. Would you stand with us and sing? This is a time of reflection, a time of response. If God is calling you to do something, maybe you just need to pray and say, God, I have had a closed mind, and I've seen people different than me and just decided, you know, I'm not even going to bother telling them about Jesus. They're from another religion or from another place or whatever. They don't need to know, but they do. Maybe you need to respond and repent of that. Maybe you just have a prayer request you want to share with us today. Here's your chance to respond. Bridget has come this morning and wants us to pray.